And then they wanted to even stone Moses because of no water to drink when the Amalekites were there. And it says, and Moses said unto Joshua, choose us out men and go out and fight with them, with Amalek. And tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand. Nobody could manifest the power in that rod except Moses. They wanted to stone him. And now here was the Amalekites. If they had killed Moses and stoned Moses because of water to drink, you might get water to drink, and then you get rid of the man, and then the Amalekites came. What are you going to do? It was Moses that solved the problem. And then he says, so Joshua did as Moses had said unto him, and fought with Amalek. And Moses and Aaron and all went to the top of the hill. And it came to pass when Moses held up his hand that Israel prevailed, and when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. Anytime that Moses was tired, enemies prevailed. Anytime his hands were down, enemies prevailed. Anytime he was so discouraged and depressed, unhappy, and he couldn't, you know, keep up his Sunday anymore because he has so much pressure upon his life, enemies prevailed. That's why we're told that in verse 12, but Moses' hands were heavy, and he took his stone and put it under him, and he sat thereon. And Aaron and all stayed up his hands, the one on the one side and the other on the other side, and his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. What's the result? I said, what's the result? And Joshua discomfited Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. I wish I were there in the land of Israel, and I tell those people, be reasonable, be wise, stop all the murmuring. Let Moses have some fresh air to breathe so that he'll be able to minister the best unto you. Let's look at Numbers chapter 14, highlighting the deadly disease of murmuring. That thing killed them, destroyed them. Their murmuring injured them, hurt them. And the murmuring was about non-essentials. Have you ever thought about that? Non-essentials. Food, water to drink, the mundane things of this life. And they forgot the very essential, important things of life. Murmuring. We're looking at Numbers chapter 14, verse 21. But as truly as I live, all the earth shall be filled with the glory of the Lord, because all those men which have seen my glory and my miracles, which I did in Egypt and in the wilderness, and have tempted me now these 10 times, and I'm not hearkening to my voice, surely they shall not see the land which I swear unto their fathers, neither shall any of them that provoke me see it. Their murmuring cut them off from the land of Canaan. These people were not thinking of the future. Moses had told them the land we're going is a land filled with a lot of things, a land flowing with milk and honey. Whatever you miss here today, you're going to get it in the land we're going, because all the fruits of the land, all the houses of the people, all the fertile ground, everything belongs to you. Just be patient a little, and not more because of the heat of the day today, because of the future. Think of the future, think of yourself, and think of the great reward that is coming unto you. And when you think of that, then the present day needs or pressures or problems are not going to be so important. You look at verse 26. In verse 26, and the Lord spake unto Moses and unto Aaron, saying, how long shall I bear with this evil congregation which murmur against me? Have you noticed something here? At this time now, they need to worship idol, but God just overlooked that. At this time, they didn't make any idol to themselves. God just overlooked that. At this time, they didn't call the name of the Lord in vain. God overlooked that. At this time, they were not breaking the Sabbath day law. God overlooked that. At this time, they were honoring their father and honoring their mother. God overlooked that. At this time, they were not stealing. They were not committing adultery. They were not being covetous. All the commandments, everything was in place. There was no complaint about that. Only this murmuring. You know what murmuring does? Every other good quality in your life becomes overlooked. A every other good thing you do. You're living a righteous life, you're living a holy life, and then you are, you know, giving to the poor, you are very generous, you are merciful, you are compassionate. Every other thing is in place in your life. When murmuring comes in, every other good thing is overlooked. You lose the benefit of the good things you have done, of the good things you are doing. When the murmuring comes in, and the Lord said, how long shall I bear with this evil congregation which murmur against me? I have heard their murmurings, the murmurings of the children of Israel, which they murmur against me. Say unto them, as truly as I live, says the Lord, as ye have spoken in my ears, so will I do to you. Your carcasses shall fall in this wilderness. They will die. That's why we call the murmuring a life-threatening disease. It killed them. It destroyed them. Look at verse 36. In verse 36, it says, and the men which Moses sent to search the land, who returned and made all the congregation to murmur against him. They made the congregation to murmur by what they said, by the evil report they gave. The Lord hated murmuring so much that even the people that instigated that murmuring by bringing up his slander upon the land, even those men in verse 37 that did bring up the evil report upon the land died by the plague before the Lord. You see that? Cut short their lives. Murmuring, a life-threatening disease. It's not something we gamble with, something we play with. So when we murmur, we instigate other people, influence other people to murmur. Cut short our lives. All the other good qualities we have and the good things we have done, everything is forgotten because we murmur and because we allow other people to murmur. Like spoiled children, those Israelites, spoiled children, they murmured against God and against Moses, but they only groaned under the taskmasters of Egypt. Have you thought about that? What are they seeing here? More than what they saw in Egypt. In Egypt, the oppression was much. The lashes on their back. The denial forced on them. The slavery that they forced on them in Egypt. They didn't murmur. They didn't murmur against Pharaoh. They didn't murmur against those taskmasters. All they did was to cry, not murmur. All they did was to groan, oh Lord, look at our condition. They didn't murmur. When you think about the church, and where maybe you're teaching in school, and your principal, your headmaster, is kind of ferocious, furious, and a tyrant. You don't murmur. You send prayer request. Church, pray for me. I'm going through a hard time. Over there you cry. Over there you groan. Over here you come to murmur. And then when your landlord, he comes and he says, now I double the rent. He did that 3 months ago. And he comes and he says again, hey, everybody, I want to renovate my house. If you're not happy, if you want to go, go. If you want to stay, I'm adding this. You only groan, you don't murmur. You cry, you pray, you fast. But when you come to the church, with all the good things happening to us in the church, with all the blessings we're receiving in the church, a little problem. The things we endure with the landlords, the things we endure with our principals at school, the things we deal with all those directors and managers and the people that are ruling over us there with tyranny. We don't grumble. We don't even leave the job. We even stay on the job. We're afraid if I lose this job, what else will I get? If a fraction of that happens to us in the church, we're saying, which church will I go? I think I'll go to that church. I think I'll go to that church because this is our deeper life. Look at this. Look at this. Hey, look at this. We taught you about salvation. You knew nothing about salvation until our leaders taught you. It was sanctification and the joy of the Lord and the hope of heaven. All the good things you have received, you forgot everything. And here you murmur and murmur, over there you endure. Come on now, turn around and give us some breathing space and show some patience, the kind of patience to show. to the people who are pressing in your places of work. Look at Exodus chapter 2. Exodus chapter 2. I'm reading there from verse 23. Exodus chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 23. And see the attitude of those children of Israel when those taskmasters oppressed them. They didn't murmur then. How is it? It was when Moses came and left everything behind, leading them in the wilderness of the land of Canaan. That's when murmuring started. Chapter 2 of Exodus, verse 23. And it came to pass in process of time that the king of Egypt died. And the children of Israel sighed by reason of the bondage, and they cried, they didn't murmur, and their cry came up unto God by reason of the bondage, and God heard their groaning. God, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and with Jacob, and God looked upon the children of Israel, and God had respect unto them. Why didn't they manifest such attitude now that the Lord has done so much for them? No, it was only murmuring at this time. Let's look at Psalm 106. Psalm 106. I'm reading from verse 21. Psalm 106, verse 21. They forgot God, their Savior. That's what murmuring does. Makes us to forget what Jesus did on the cross of Calvary. His groaning, his tears, his cry, his pain, the crucifixion, his bearing a punishment for us. We forget that when we begin to murmur. It says they forgot God, their Savior, which had done great things in Egypt. Wondrous works in the land of Ham and terrible things by the Red Sea. Therefore he said that he would destroy them. Had not Moses his chosen stood before him in the breach to turn away his wrath, lest he should destroy them. Yea, they despised the pleasant land and they believed not his word, but murmured in their tents. Murmured in their tents. Instead of remembering the promises of God and repeating the promises of God and claiming the promises of God and praying with the promises of God, murmuring canceled the prayer. Murmuring weakened their faith. Murmuring kind of blocked their memory. They couldn't even remember the great things the Lord had done, but they murmured in verse 25 in their tents, and they hearkened not unto the voice of the Lord. Therefore he lifted up his hand against them and to overthrow them in the wilderness, and to overthrow their seed also among the nations, and to scatter them in the lands. How about the things they even murmured about? Look at verse 15. He gave them their request, but sent leanness into their soul. When you ask for the blessing of God in the normal way, you enjoy that blessing when it comes. But when you get it by murmuring, when you get it by rioting, when you get it by instigating other people, when you get it by striving and kind of chiding with Moses and the leadership, you might get it eventually. You have your way, but it sends leanness to your soul. What benefit are you going to receive from that? We're looking at Jude, verse 11. Jude, I read from verse 11. The people that murmur today, what happens to them? What do they get to eventually? Jude, verse 11. Woe unto them, for they have gone in the way of Cain and ran greedily after the error of Balaam for reward, and perished in the gainsaying of Korah. That's Korah. Korah murmured of Dathan and Abiram. And he told Moses, you make yourself somebody, and you put yourself on the congregation. The whole congregation is holy. Are you making yourself as if you are a special person? That's what they said. Those people, they forgot the whole congregation. When they needed water, why didn't they go to the whole congregation? Why did they come to Moses? And when they needed food, why did they go to Moses? If everybody was like Moses. And when the plague was breaking out and destroying thousands of them, why didn't they go to all those people? Everybody is holy, everybody is righteous, and everybody can do what you are doing. Why did they go to them? The murmuring was unreasonable. And it says in the church, there are people that go in the way of Korah. that he is in the gates and he perish. It says these are spots, verse 12, in your feast of charity, when they feast with you, feeding themselves without fear. Clouds they are without water, carried about of winds, trees whose fruits withereth, without fruit, twice dead, plucked up by the roots. Those are the murmurers. You know, when you begin to murmur like that, it serves your own Christian life. You become shallow, you become empty, you become dry. Whatever you are passing out is just of the flesh. Because of a murmuring of recent, you've been murmuring recently, and since you are murmuring, the Spirit of God cannot remain, the freshness of the Lord cannot remain, insight into the divine will cannot remain. They're just dry and shallow and superficial. And since now there are clouds without water, and the trees whose fruits are twice dead all over, reaching waves in verse 13 of the sea, foaming out their own shame, wandering stars to whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, behold, the Lord cometh with ten thousands of his saints to execute judgment upon all, and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all the ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed, and of all their hard speeches. Hard speeches. When people murmur, they say things that say, you ought not to say that. You can say that against God, against Christ. When they murmur, you open your mouth, you can do that against our leader. You can say that against our group coordinator. When they murmur, they forget themselves. And they have these hard speeches which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. These are murmurers. Verse 16, they are murmurers, complainers, walking after their own lusts. And their mouth speaketh great swelling words, having men's persons in admiration because of advantage. What that means is, if somebody is murmuring and you don't appreciate it, don't stop. If you don't smile, if you don't look at them, if you don't appreciate them, if you just say, you of all people say you can do that, and then you look away. And you see that murmuring belittles them. Murmuring kind of cuts them down. Murmuring makes them nothing. And then when they see that everybody is looking away, that they see that as a whole church, we don't appreciate people that murmur against God, and they murmur against our pastor, against our leaders, they'll stop. Because it says what they want, they have men's persons, or males and persons in admiration. Once you admire them and you are congratulating them, and you are bold, you are courageous, to have murmured against Moses, against Aaron, against the Lord, I kind of envy you. I couldn't have done that, but you people, you are bold. Oh, and once we are like that, and they know that that's what they are looking for. They have males, persons in admiration. But if you look down them, I'll just say, well, I didn't know you could do that, as you've done that. I'm sorry, my hand is not that. I'm not going to praise you for that. They'll stop. Point number two. Healing the deadly disease of murmuring. Get it healed. Get it healed. Not allow it to fester, to expand, to continue. Isaiah chapter 29, verse 23, verse 24. Isaiah chapter 29, verse 23. But when he seeth his children, the work of mine hand, in the midst of him, they shall sanctify my name, and sanctify the Holy One of Jacob, and shall fear the God of Israel. They also that hear the Spirit shall come to understanding, and they that murmured shall do what? Shall learn doctrine. The people that murmured in the past, when the Lord's hand begins to touch us,